were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally makes the change. We were made to be courageous. We were made to be courageous. We were warriors on the front line, standing unafraid. Now we're watchers on the sidelines as our families slip away. Where are you, men of courage? We were made for so much more. May the pounding of our hearts cry, we will serve the Lord. We were made to be courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. Lord, make us courageous. This is our resolution, our answer to the call. We will love our wives and children. We refuse to let them fall. We will reignite the passion that we've buried deep inside. Let the watchers become warriors. Let the men of God arise. We were made to be courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. Lord, make us courageous. Seek justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God.
Seek justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God.
In the war of the mind, I will make my stand. In the battle of the heart and the battle of the hand. In the war of the mind, I will make my stand. In the battle of the heart and the battle of the hand. We were made to be courageous. We're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. Lord, make us courageous.
Making sure my tie was on straight. I enjoyed that. And I heard some comments about Father's Day. And I would like to just make my comment about Father's Day. I think that baptizing Kevin and Anwar is maybe the best Father's Day gift I could ever receive.
Amen.
And I'm very thankful that you all could share that gift with me. And I'm also very thankful that you all have shared in fathering and mothering and parenting Kevin and Anabar. and Jose. It's been said it takes a village to raise a child. And I believe that's true. It takes a community. And so I thank you, each and every one of you, for every part you've played. Some at home, some visiting, some at parties and gatherings, but each one of you have made an impact on their life. And I don't know about Father's Day, I don't know about Mother's Day, I just know about parenting. And you all have been great parents and co-parents with me.
Amen.
Okay, why don't you change the mics yet again?
Sorry.
That's okay. We want it to work. So I thank each one of you for that. We're going to talk about vision. And we're going to talk about this church's vision. And we're going to talk about how relevant this church's vision is to the world we live in. We're going to talk about relevance more later in the year, too, because relevance is actually one of the values of the Solid Rock Church. We believe in relevance, and we believe in the things that we do must be relevant to the people that we serve. And although I didn't plan, I did plan to preach this passage today, I couldn't have planned the events of this week. And the events of this week have made the passage I want to preach about this week and have planned to preach about for at least several months now even more important, even more on cue, and even more relevant to us. And relevant to what we're doing and who we are and where we're going and what we're becoming. Because our DNA has really changed. There are people that are not Fairfax people, and there are people that are not Arlington people. There are people who attend here who are Solid Rock people. Because what we do and how we do it has changed, because we're about doing what we see God sending us to. And we want to keep being that kind of church. So my sermon is entitled The Vision of the Rock, because we want to have a vision. We want to see who we are. We're talking about identity in Christ all year long, but we want to not only know who we are in Christ, we want to know who we're becoming in Christ.
Amen.
And we want to know how God is going to work through us, both as individuals, but also us as a congregation. And as God continues to change us, we continue to need to change the world. Because quite honestly, what has happened this week is beyond my ability to, I think you need to bring my volume down just a little bit, I'm going to hit some feedback here. What has happened this week is beyond our ability to even process. Because this was not someone flying an airplane into a building who snuck into our country. This week was an issue of identity. What was it an issue of?
Identity.
Identity. In fact, there are all kinds of issues of identity all over this, and you've been hearing it repeatedly over and over. But the shooter who killed 49 people was an American. Was born in this country. He chose a different self-identity. You were born a child of God. But what identity you choose will determine what kind of impact you have in this world. No different than that shooter who was born an American but chose
to affiliate himself with a different kind of identity. You are born a child of Jesus. You are born a child of the Father. But what are you going to do with that identity? For some people in this world, there's nothing more valuable than American citizenship. I mean, I'm just being honest. I'm not being ethnocentric because I'm not American. But for some people in this world, money can't buy American citizenship. For some people in this world, American is their goal. It offers protection. It offers wealth. It offers prestige. It offers something you can't find other places. But this man, who was given it at birth, a lesser identity. This is for us as Christians, because we have been not identity that is highly valued in the world, but that is the most important identity in the universe. And we too could throw it away. And we too could choose to associate with a different identity that would wreak havoc in our world. Now, there are all other kinds of identity. People are talking about, well, these people were gay, and these people, you know, this is a gay and lesbian nightclub, and, you know, maybe, you know, there have been mixed feelings about that, and there's been, quite honestly, some embarrassing things that Christians have said that have just shamed me. And when Christians say embarrassing things, like some of the things I've heard this week, you know, I just want to hang my head low. But then there's been the upswing. There's been Christians who've come and offered of themselves freely. At least 3 Adventist churches in Florida has performed so far 3 funerals free of cost to the victims' families. Because this is about choosing identity. We can talk about the identity that the victims had. We can talk about the identity that the predator had. But what about the identity that the church has? Because I don't know that I can change the identity of someone who wants to be a murderer. And I don't know if other people who have other problems want to change their identity. That's up to them and God. But what I know is what my identity needs to be. And when I know what my identity needs to be, then I will know how to treat people with dignity, regardless of what their identity is. All I know about those 49 people who were murdered is that God loved each one of them. Amen. In fact, I know one other thing about them. God gave his only begotten son for all 49 of them. Amen. And that's enough for me as a Christian to love them, to care for them, and yes, to try to instruct and lead them, but not to judge them. And so we have this problem. And so, you know, you turn on cable news, which is the worst thing anyone can do in your life. Cable news is dangerous. I don't care if you're of which variety you like. Cable news supports itself through ratings, which is never a safe place to get information. But if you turn on the cable news, you hear these questions. What happened to America? And quite frankly, the questions aren't just on cable news. The questions are in my mind, too. Probably in your mind too. What has happened to America? How did we get in this situation? How are we in this situation when we are arguing over who uses which restroom? How did we get in a situation where we are arguing over what does it mean to be an American? You were born here, you were naturalized, or you traded your identity and declared your allegiance to someone else in the middle of a phone call. how did America get here? And so there's a lot of answers that fly around. And you know what I found? I found that Christians have a lot of answers. They have a lot of answers of how we got here and what the problem is. And the problem, though, is most of those answers that Christians have about how we got here and what the problem is to blame it on people who are not Christian. Okay. If you listen to now Christian preachers, now I'm talking about. And I'm being careful because I'm a Christian preacher. But if you listen to them, they will talk about the eroding of the family, and they will talk about the eroding of moral values in America, and they will talk about God is angry with us because of what we allow to happen in our country. Some of them will even say, this is God's payback. It was payback to people who are living out of his will, and it's payback for us for not making them live in his will. You will hear all kinds of things, but even amongst sincere Christians, even amongst the saints, maybe even amongst yourselves and in your own mind, we blame the condition of our nation, the condition of the morality of America, on people who are different than us. Maybe people who are of a different religion, maybe people of a different lifestyle, maybe even simply people who go to church on a different day. Maybe we're not that much different than those who make those accusations. But really, you know, what good does finger pointing do? What good does raising your fist do? I mean, what are we going to do? I mean, are we literally going to go out and try to determine who is radicalized? I mean, are we literally going to go out and spy on each other? I mean, are we literally going to try to find who's at blame and then pass a law to change it? I mean, is this what God's plan is for the church? Because remember, the context that we began this sermon on before this event happened last week, the context was, what is the vision of the church? Where do we see the church going? What do we see the church doing? You know, and so are we just going to be those who point fingers? Also sad was this little boy who died in Orlando, Florida, in Disneyland, but I found this image telling. You know, it's not a real image. It's meant to be humorous. But it speaks to the inner psyche of America. We are looking for a scapegoat for everything. And when did it become the church's job to cast blame? When did it become the church's job to accuse people? When did it become the church's job to judge the ungodly? Or is it the church's job to judge the godly? And so as we look at these things, we're stuck wondering, and we really don't need to be stuck wondering, because the Bible gives us a very famous passage that really every Christian probably knows. You probably learned it in Sabbath school or Sunday school. You probably know the whole story of how David wanted to build a temple, and how God said, no, you have too much blood on your hands, and you know, you're a man of war. It will be your son who builds the temple. And then Solomon wants to build the temple, and Solomon just asked one thing from God, and that's wisdom. And Solomon builds the temple, and they're making sacrifices to this new to God at the new temple, dedicating the temple. And fire comes down then and consumes the sacrifices, and the Shekinah glory, the very essence of God, goes and dwells in the temple. And that night, when Solomon goes to sleep, God begins to talk to him. And God begins to give Solomon a plan. It's what I call a congruency plan, or an exit strategy, or a repairment plan. God says, if there's a time that Israel should go wrong, if there's a time that Israel should go astray, if there's a time where Israel gets in such a mess that we don't know how to clean it up, this is my plan for my people. Now, it's true that this prayer exegetically is not about America. It's not about even the church, and it's not about solid rock. What it is about is Israel and God's plan for them. But it fits us. And we quote it a lot. And let's read 14 together. We're going to read a lot of verses together today. Actually, we're going to read a lot of same verse together today. Let's read this together. We all know it. If who are called by my name, what? Humble themselves and pray and see my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will what?
Hear
from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. Does anyone think that there could be some relevance to this prayer? This plan that God gave Solomon. But we read this prayer, or the solution that God gave Solomon. We read it, we talk about it, but we don't really notice what it says. We like how it makes us feel. God says, I will heal your land. God says, I will forgive you. God says, I will make everything right again. And we like that. But are we paying attention to everything it's telling us? Are we paying attention to what it's telling us we need to be as a church in a fallen world where hate rules? Because this is what it's telling us. Who should humble themselves? Politicians? People we don't agree with? People who are contrary to us? No, it's not what it says. It says, my people. The solution to the problem in the world is us humbling ourselves, which seems to be the direct contrary approach that Christians are using. Now, what else does it say? It says we should pray. Who should pray, though? Again, it says God's people should pray. Who should pray? God's people. Well, what about this? We know that we should humble ourselves, and we know that we should pray. What else? Who is God waiting on to act? Is he waiting on some politician to come up with a strategy to take out ISIL? Is God waiting on the church to stand up for what's morally right in this world and send politicians to D.C.? Is God waiting for enough people to sign some petition or be in some picket, some rally or demonstration? No, not according to the text we read. He's waiting on those who are what? Called by his name. I have a question, church. Are you called by his name? That was pretty weak. Are you called by his name? If you're called by his name, then this is what he says to you. When you see these problems, when you see these crises, when you see these struggles, stop pointing your fingers. I am waiting for you to humble yourself. I am waiting for you to pray. And I am waiting for you, if you are called by my name, to call out to me. You see, why do we assume that people who don't know Jesus will have the solution to these problems? They won't. And so, maybe, could it be that the problem is the church and not the world. This might be too much to bite off. President's coming next week. I'm really going to be in trouble. Could it be that the problem is not the world? It's the church. Do you know what I mean by that? I mean this. Maybe the world is getting as bad as it is because the church is too busy being angry. The church is too busy judging. The church is too busy attacking to go out and care, to go out and love, to go out and preach God's love to fallen people. And maybe the world gets to the place where it is because the church is where it is. You know, I don't think God left America. I don't think America left God. I think the church left God. And the church became irrelevant to Americans. And I think that the over-sexualization of everything and the overstimulation of everything and the things you see on TV and all these things that we're always concerned about is not a direct result of just the world, but it's the direct result of the world not being impacted by the power of the church. Do we invite our neighbors to church? Do we share about Jesus on the bus? Do we seek to care about a person who's just having a hard day? You don't have to know them. You know when someone's having a hard day. You can tell. What if the church was relevant again? You see, America was very churchy when the church was relevant for where America is. But what if the church was relevant again? What if the church was not just this place that pointed fingers, not just this place that lifted up rocks, not just this place that wanted to judge people who chose different paths, but what if this church was a place that although it stood for a truth, had a truth, would not back down from a truth, still loved people, still supported people, and stopped judging people? What impact could that make to change everything? Maybe the problem is that Jesus attends our church weekly and pleads us weekly to come help him in his mission. Because sometimes what happens is we are so caught up with our own mission. When I mean our own mission, I don't mean Solid Rock's mission, because I believe that's Jesus' mission. I mean my mission, your mission. I mean just trying to get through the week. I mean just trying to get a good job. I mean just trying to pay the bills. I mean just trying to get by. I mean just trying to have a little bit of entertainment. I mean just trying to have a good time once in a while. And we forget how serious this world is. What last Sunday taught us is how serious this world is and how seriously this world needs Jesus. How seriously this world needs a church that cares enough to do more than just come to church for an hour a week. How serious this world is that it needs a church that brings Jesus wherever its members are. Isn't that the gospel? Doesn't Jesus live in you? Then Jesus should live in every part of the world and every part of the life that you have. And so maybe that's the point here. Again, look at our passage today. If, read it with me again. If
my people.
If my people. Are you his people?
Yes.
my people what?
Who are called by my name.
Are you called by his name?
Yes. Yes.
If my people who are called by my name do what?
Humble themselves.
Are you willing to humble yourself?
Amen.
And?
Pray.
Are you willing to pray?
Amen.
And?
Seek my face.
And seek my face. And?
Turn from their wicked ways.
Turn from whose wicked ways?
Ours.
Their wicked ways. Then I will what?
Hear from heaven.
I will hear from heaven. And I will what?
Forgive their sins.
Forgive their sins. And do what?
Heal the land.
And heal their land. Who is it that God is calling to repent in this passage? Is it the world? It's Israel. And I want you to know something. In the context of this passage, God is calling Israel to repent ahead of time because they're not in sin at this time. They just built the temple, did a bunch of sacrifices, and had a great time, and Shekinah glory came down and was with them. But God's saying to them that it could go wrong at some point, and when it goes wrong, repent. Don't pass the buck, don't point the finger, don't blame somebody else. What about you? What it says is his people should seek his face and should turn from their wicked ways. And you say, well, you know, I don't go to those kind of nightclubs and I don't belong to any guys groups and, you know, I only listen to soft rock even, you know. I don't got HBO because I heard that's bad, you know. I limit my television and I don't have any of those bad apps. But what the church seems to have in spades is apathy. What the church seems to have in spades is judgment and lack of sincerity. Not necessarily us, but I'm just talking about generally in Christianity. When a person can go on the internet after 49 people are killed and say that this was God's judgment, I mean, how is it that Christians even tolerate somebody like that? You know, we're going to be seeing in the coming weeks boycotting of the funerals by certain Christian groups and so forth. You know, the Apostle Paul talked about this kind of attitude. The Apostle Paul said this kind of attitude is actually, you know, they show a form of godliness. Like they got their suits pressed nice and they got okay ties and they come to church on the right day and the offer. They're up and they get to church rather late, but they get there. But where's the power? Where's the power? You see, the sin of church is not homosexuality per se or radicalization per se. It's a different kind of sin. The sin of the church is a lack of power because they don't pray for power. The sin of the church is a lack of power because they don't pray for power, because they don't think they need power, because they think that they can just vote the way out of messes. The sin of the church is they don't pray for power, so they don't get power, because they think that something is just going to happen to fix everything, because after all, it's America. The sin of the church is this is God's connection point with the world. But we gotta connect. And so what we find is God calling the church back to prayer, God calling the church back to power, God calling the church back to relevance. You know, why do we try to change things with human efforts? We try to change things with human efforts when we stop believing in divine power. It's true. And whenever we engage in seeking to change the world with human efforts, it means we have no faith in divine power. God's call to the church is pray. God's call to the church is you could change all of this if you prayed. God's call to the church is, you have no idea what could happen in Orlando if you prayed. You have no idea what could happen in D.C. if you prayed. You have no idea what could happen in our great cities like L.A. and Chicago and New York and all of them if we prayed. God's message to the church is, there's no politics, there's no strategy, there's no group you can join that can have the power that the church can have if they pray. And God keeps calling us. He says, if my people who are called by my name, if my people who are called by my name just came to prayer meeting, if my people who are called by my name just came to the morning devotional, if my people who are called by my name just logged in on Friday nights, if my people who are called by my name just came for Sabbath school, if my people who are called by my name just became more serious about being called by my name. By the way, there's a commandment that goes, thou shalt not take the Lord's name in. It's not talking about cussing. It's talking about saying that you're God's child and not being his child. So God is saying, when Christians would get serious again about being Christians, when Christians would get serious again about impacting their communities, when Christians would get serious about going back to the home shelters and going back to pregnancy centers and going back to the nursing home ministries and back to all the food bank ministries we do and all those great things we do. But when we get serious about it, when we organize about it, and when we go forward, we will actually make an impact in this world. A bigger impact than we can do if my people who are called by my name humbled themselves and what? And not just less light praying, but seek what? My face. Turn away from their wicked ways. What else? Then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. God has a plan to heal America. It has nothing to do with a Democrat, a Republican, or a third-party candidate. It has everything to do with his church. You can change more than cable news can change the world. You can change more than laws can change the world. You can change more than popular culture can change the world. When you unite with God in prayer, that's when he says he heals our land. That's when he says he heals our land. In fact, he has a lot to say. He goes on in verse 15 to say, now my eyes will be what? Now my eyes will be open and my ears will be what? Attentive. My eyes will be open. My ears will be attentive to the prayer that is made where? In this place. Again, God is putting the emphasis on God's people. In the exegetical passage, he means Israel and he means at the temple, but the same principle applies to us. My eyes will be open, my ears will be attentive, and the prayers that are made in this place will be heard for what? For now I have chosen what? And consecrated what? This house. How long? Forever. Do you understand what he's saying? It's not just for Israel, it's for you. And his plan has not changed. If you want to see this world heal, if you want to see this country heal, if you want to see these people heal, it means you must kneel. Read it with me. For now I have chosen, and come on, and consecrate this house, consecrated this house, that my name may be there, how long? Forever. And my eyes and my heart be there for all time. This is not limited to Israel. The same plan for us. If we will heed his voice, if we will hear his voice, if we will get serious about our religious experience, if we will be sincere with our prayer, if we will spend time with God, he will instruct us, he will prepare us, and he will make us a church that changes this world for all time. In fact, I believe this passage applies to this church, to all churches, but to this church. This church needs to become that place that he has chosen. You're not here by accident. We didn't merge these churches by accident. We didn't make these things happen by accident. We were led this moment by God. And there's not a person in the room who was not led here by God. Some of you don't know each other's names, but it doesn't matter because God knows your name, and he led you here to hear the same message that he is preparing a people that he wants to make serious about their faith. He's preparing a people that he wants to make serious about prayer. He's preparing a people that he wants to make serious about healing his land. And all it takes is for us to choose to be here, and for us to choose to pray, and for us to choose to believe, and for us to choose to see how God is going to lead us. But God is saying that it is the church that is to be that safe place in the community for everyone. That brings us to our vision statement. Our vision statement, we read it once today. Here it is again. To become a house of prayer and healing that what? People of all nations in the unity of truth of the scriptures. That's what we're doing. We are becoming a people who don't blame. We are becoming a people who don't point fingers. We are becoming a people who aren't angry but are Holy Spirit filled. We're becoming a people who believe in the impossible. And we're becoming a people who will follow Jesus into the impossible. And we're becoming a people who will make the church be a safe haven for people. Even people we might not agree with, but can still love and teach into truth. This is what we're about. This is why we exist. I was reminded about the impossible this week. I was reading a story about a boy named Jimmy in a Bill Hybel book. Jimmy was having supper with his parents one night, and after supper, they had a tradition of playing cards, and they played some cards, and then his mom told him to go upstairs and get his nightly bath before he went to bed. So Jimmy went upstairs to go to bed. But he didn't take his bath. He went into his room to get clothes for his bath. But when he went into his room to get clothes for his bath, he looked up out the window. And there was this big full moon. And this big full moon caught Jimmy's attention. And he couldn't take his eyes off of it. And so his mom came in, you can imagine, she's a little bit annoyed. She's like, we had our fun time, we played games and had dinner, but you were supposed to be up here having a bath. And I find you just laying on your bed, you know, your hands over your head, and you're looking at the window of this moon, what are you doing? And Jimmy says, Mom, I'm going there. I'm gonna walk on that thing. At the time Jimmy said that, I don't know that anyone had ever done such a thing. know how you can be when you're a parent. You're like, you don't want to crush your kids' dreams, but you don't want to set them up for failure either. You know, this kid is talking about walking on the moon, you know. Jimmy would have a long trek to the moon. Actually, at one point in his life, he would break 32 bones in an accident. But he made it to the moon. One of 12 people ever to stand on the moon. What might you say? I mean, we all know Neil Armstrong's words, right? One small step for me, a giant step for humanity. But what would you say if you walked on the moon? And we never hear Jimmy Irwin's statement about walking in the moon. But here's what he said about walking on the moon. Jesus walking on the earth was more important than man walking on the moon. If a little boy could find his way from his little bedroom to the moon and walk on it, and then realize Jesus walking on the earth is more important than what he just did, what are we waiting for? We can walk any place we want. We can go any place we want. We can be anything we want. We can be charged. We can be filled. We can be completed. We can be whole. We can be full. We can be filled. It's not going to be easy. There might be 32 broken bones along the way. But if you believe, then you will humble yourself. If you believe, you will pray. If you believe, you'll ask God to hear us. You'll ask God to show us. You'll ask God to move us. If little Jimmy could come back from the moon, Jesus can bring you back from wherever you're at. Let him bring you back, and let him bring you to more important work than walking on the moon. Because Jimmy Irwin says, Jesus walking on the earth is more impressive. But you know what Jesus says? I want to walk on the earth again. But you're wearing my shoes. We are called to be the Jesus this world needs. We are called to bring the Jesus this world needs. He resides in our hearts. In the book of Romans says, how sweet are the feet who bring gospel news. We have a message for Orlando. We have a message for Washington, D.C. We have a message for Chicago. We have a message for New York City. We have a message for L.A. We have a message for China. We have a message for Brazil. We have a message for Australia. We have a message for the world. It's called Three Angels. But he needs us to humble ourselves.
Amen.
He needs us to pray. And he needs us to seek his face.
Amen.
Let us at least have the faith of a 12-year-old boy who says he's going to walk on the moon. I meant what I said when I was in the baptistry. Some of you need baptism. Some of you have never been baptized. Some of you have never made a full commitment to Jesus Christ. Jesus is calling you. I know he's calling you because it's going through my switchboard. You have a card. If you need baptism, check it. I will call you. I will email you. I will contact you. Some of you just need to make the decision to follow Jesus. You're not ready for baptism, perhaps, but you need to be fully committed. Maybe you can't make prayer meeting, maybe you can't make the devotion call, but you just know that there's something more you got to do. You just want to follow Jesus a little bit more. There's a place on your card for that. Some of you might want to serve at the church because you hear that we need to impact the community. But you know, the truth is, we have a lot of people attending, but we need more people serving. And not just on Sabbath morning, but in the food banks, in the shelters, in the nursing homes, in the outreach program, going door to door. You can check that. Most importantly, we're going to be praying because we're going to humble ourselves. And we're going to seek His face. And we would like to humble ourselves. And we would like, Father, I pray that we will become a praying church. This coming Friday night, we have a special prayer and fasting night. And Father, I pray that between now and Friday, people would seek their heart, would seek Your face, and would make plans to be here to pray together as a church, to seek after You as a church. Father, some people have different schedules, different things going on in their life, but wherever they are, Father, we just pray that You would make each one of us a praying person, a caring person, a loving person. Because, Father, when we pray, when we humble ourselves, then we will finally be a safe place for lost sinners. And most of all, Father, we pray that You will make us a safe place for lost sinners, that this truly would be a house of prayer for all nations. And our unity will truly come from Your word. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.